Hey, it's good to see you tonight on our first night of Revival Missions Conference, and so glad that you're here. Let's stand together. Let's sing Our God, a Firm Foundation, Only King Forever. Let's join with us together as we sing that. Go ahead and be seated if you will.
Jesus told us 2,000 years ago that our mission is to go and make disciples of all nations. He also promised us that only after we accomplish that task will we receive the blessing of His return. So, how are we doing accomplishing our mission? To answer that, let's classify the 7 billion people on the earth today into three groups. Let's start with the Christians. About 33% of the world's population would identify itself as Christian. We call this segment of the population World C, C for Christian. It's important to remember that not all of the people that fall into World C are true believers in Christ. They merely identify themselves as Christian because of nominal belief in Jesus, or because they live in a country where everyone is considered Christian, so they would do the same. Next, there's the 38% of the world that has access to the gospel but has chosen not to follow Jesus. They have Bibles in their language, churches nearby, friends or co-workers who are potentially Christians, or access to other Christian resources in their language. These people have access to the good news, but just haven't acted on it yet. This segment of the population is called World B. That leaves us with 29% of the world, just over 1 out of every 4 people on this planet who not only have never heard of Jesus, they have no chance of hearing the good news of Jesus Christ. They have no access to the gospel, no Bibles, no churches, no believers nearby, no chance to learn about Jesus. We call that 29% World A. Now, on to missionaries. Only 1 out of every 1,800 Christians in World C decides to serve as a cross-cultural missionary. So, we can pull 400,000 missionaries out of that World C population. That's our total cross-cultural missionary force worldwide. Did you know that 72% of all our missionaries are going to World C? That's right. The vast majority of the missionaries being sent out are going to the people of the world that have Bibles and established churches. 25% of the missionaries are sent to World B, where there is already some access to the church and to the Bible. That leaves only 3% of the total missionary force to handle all of World A, the section of the population without any chance of hearing about Jesus. 29% of the world has no way to hear the gospel, but we're sending only a tiny portion of our Christian workers to them. What about finances? Annually, all those Christians in World C earn a total of $42 trillion. And together, they give about $700 billion to Christian causes each year. That includes everything: Christian nonprofits, churches, youth programs, missions, etc. Can you do the math? Less than 2% of Christian income is being given to Christ's causes. Out of that $700 billion given to all Christian causes, only $45 billion is given to missions specifically. That's a little over 6%. In fact, there is more money reported embezzled from the church each year than is given to missions. Remember those 400,000 missionaries? We have $45 billion to support them and their cross-cultural work. But how exactly is it allocated? Well, $39 billion goes to World C every year. Yep, 87% of that missions money is being spent in areas of the world that have Bibles and churches available. $5.4 billion, or 12%, goes to World B each year, those that have access to the gospel message but have rejected it. That leaves only $450 million, or 1% of all missions money, going to World A, the least reached people of the world. To put that into perspective, annually, Americans spend more money on Halloween costumes for their pets than gets sent to World A. To summarize, only 3% of our missionary force, armed with only 1% of missions giving, is going out to reach the 2 billion people who don't have access to the gospel. 2 billion people are still waiting for the good news of Jesus Christ. So here's a question for you. What are you going to do to change that?
Amen. Humbling, isn't it? Well, let's try that one more time. Humbling, isn't it? I will tell you, what an impact when it tells you that more money is reported embezzled by the church than is given to missions in geography A. Isn't that something? There's the question, and that's the question we're going to ask this week, and that is, what are you going to do about it? Because we can give more to missions if we're willing to, right? We can do more for missions if we're willing to. And so our question this week to you, and what we're going to work on the next 3 days, is what are you going to do about it? What individual impact are you going to make? And I want you to think about that. We're glad that you're here tonight. The choir is going to sing in just a second. We are going to have a great week, and we've got some exciting things planned. And so we'll do some more of that throughout the service. But I hope that video sticks with you. And when you go home tonight and you pray and you ask the Lord, what is it that I can do different? You remember the statistical data that you got right here. What is it that your family can do to make an impact for the cause of Christ? Let's pray. The choir is going to sing. Father, we love you. Lord, thank you for our time together tonight. Lord, I thank you for your word. And I pray that you would speak to our hearts. And Lord, may it always be said that Friends Baptist Church is a church that cares about giving out the gospel. Lord, I ask that no matter what we do, the programs that we have, we keep our missions focus right. Lord, that we are serious about putting people on the mission field, that we are serious about putting the resources behind it. God, we need you. Lord, we want to see people come to Christ. Pray that you would help us in that. Give us a great burden. Bless the preaching tonight. Speak to our hearts. Lord, we love you. And we thank you so much. May you be honored and glorified above all else. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right. Well, what a wonderful night it is to have our second service on our missions conference. Let's go ahead, stand up, turn around, and greet a neighbor. Tell them you're glad to see them here on this wonderful Sunday night.
Good evening.
Go ahead and return to your spots. It's always great to see a church that loves to fellowship, loves to talk and enjoy one another in your company. And so find your place. You can do that after church. All right. And let's remain standing. Let's sing this song, Chainbreaker. It's a wonderful song. So find your place. Let's sing out.
You've been walking the same old road for miles and miles. If you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. If you're trying to feel the same old holes inside, there's a better life. Oh, there's a better life. If you've got pain, a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker.
You believe that this evening? Amen.
We've all searched for the light of day. Now we've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know that just ain't right. When there's a better life, oh, there's a better life. You've got pain, he's a pain taker. You feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. Somebody testify, oh, if you believe it, if you receive it, if you can't feel it, somebody testify, testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can't feel it, somebody testify. Savior, if you got chains, he's a chain breaker. If you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Come on, brother. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Good to have you in the house of the Lord. Say amen. Amen. All right. Missions. People don't like that word for some reason. I don't know, but guess what, folks? We're going to give to some missions. Give to some more missions. Amen. Take some new missionaries. I'll say amen, Pastor. Amen. He said amen. He's not a puppet, okay? He makes his own decisions. But we are. You know why? Because we need to pay some things forward, amen. God's blessed this place. There's no reason we shouldn't give. And when people bring it up, I say, well, I give now. I know you give now. And God's blessed the hound out of you, hadn't he? Amen? So that's what we need to do. And it's like Brother Jacob said this morning. It's not like he ain't got it. I mean, he's got the goods up there. We just got to appropriate it. Amen? So praise the Lord. I got chastised during the first part of the service. Peyton decided that I couldn't praise the Lord today, that she'd just do the praising for me. Amen. And so she was, I'd try to lift my hand, she'd push it down, lift hers up. So maybe that's going to be in her class she's going to do on praising. I don't know. But anyway, we're going to have some plates out in the back, and we want you to give, okay? You give as God has directed you. Don't, if you got to, you know, raise a stink about it, keep your money. But God wants a cheerful giver. He wants somebody that wants to give, because that's what he blesses. Amen, folks. I'm just telling you from experience. I've given grudgingly before, and God ain't done much with it. When I give cheerfully, God blesses that. Amen. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, thank you so much for your goodness, and thank you for giving us a little something to give. And help us to be diligent in our giving, Lord, and freely in our giving, and generous as you are generous to us. I pray that you'd just continue to bless the missions conference. Help our minds to think differently this week, that we'll have missions at the forefront of the missions of this entire church, Lord, as we endeavor to do your will. I pray in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen.
Worry.
pastor does a great job singing, doesn't he? Glad his voice is back. One of the missionaries that we support here, and we're going to highlight some missionaries throughout the week, is Brother Srinu. You've heard me talk about him before in India. We put together a little bit of a video, but let me give you a little background of what's been taking place since the last update. So we currently support Brother Srinu and his work, and we give enough that really covers his monthly expenses, him and his family, and that's about $100 a month. And it's hard to believe that they can live off of that, but they do. And that provides that he and his wife are devoted fully to the ministry. And through all of that, we are currently training 10 what we call co-pastors or co-laborers. And so we are sending out national pastors and building churches in India to further the gospel. And you're going to see a picture in the slides of a what we would call a temporary church. And it's one, it takes about, believe it or not, about $300 to buy the material, to stake it, put it up, and then to have church in this place. It is literally trees without bark and fabric that has been woven together to create a roof system. And that is how they have church. No complaining about air conditioning or heating or where to sit and things like that. They come to church, and that's church for them. And we are continuing to give and to build. My Sunday school class, we were presented a few weeks ago with the opportunity to give. They didn't ask for this, but we found the need, and our class wanted to try to meet that need. Believe it or not, they have a burden over there for Bibles. It's very hard for them to get Bibles in their native Telugu language. And what we were able to do, it takes about $5 for each Bible. And that's a nice full Bible. And that's one that they can keep. What they had been doing was they would take one Bible and they would read it, and then they would share it with another person. And they had people that they were leading to Christ, and they could not give them a full Bible. And so they had about 100 people that had been asking for Bibles in one of the churches that we had helped start. And so our class had raised enough money to purchase 50 of those Bibles. We sent $250, and you're going to see some pictures in there of those people receiving those Bibles. But what I shared with the class, and I want you to think about this, when you give money like that that impacts a life, that's generational change. It's not just a one time. It's not when you're giving out the word of God and you're spreading the gospel in that way. That is change that takes place not only in that believer, but they're then able to take that word of God and they're able to share that with their children, with their grandchildren. And that's what I mean when I say generational change. And that's one of our goals, right? We're not simply out for numbers. We're not simply out just to say, hey, 15 people receive Christ. We're looking for the discipleship and for the change in people's lives. And so that is something that we look for and we strive for as we take on missionaries. You know, gone are those days where we simply just take people on for support and keep them on forever and never hear anything from them. And so I want you to watch this video. I asked Brother Srinu to put it together too, just a little hello to the church. And just to kind of update you on things. And so he did that. And it's so funny because if you ever video call with him, he's very energetic and active and smiling. And when you have him shoot a video, he's very much not in monotone just like this. And I love him to death. He's great. And we've been friends now for many years and been involved in the ministry there for many years. But I want you to watch this video. And just think, as you give throughout this week, and at the end of the service, and the offering plates are out there. Everything that you give is going to help with our missions program here, covering the cost of the conference. But also, we're going to ask you, and I'll say more about this tomorrow night, we're going to ask you to pray about committing to give towards missions directly. And we call that faith-based missions. We want to support our missions program here more than 100%, right? And I will give you all the statistical data tomorrow night and tell you how much the church gives towards missions and all of that information. But I want you to know every dollar that's given to missions goes to missions. We don't keep any of that. Matter of fact, we cover all the administrative charges, all the fees and things like that in sending money. So we cover all that as a church. So every dollar that's given goes, and I want you to know that. I hope you enjoy the video.
Praise Lord, Prince Baptist Church family. This is Srinupal from India. I am very glad and joy to meet you through this video. In India, the pandemic conditions, we are doing good ministry. For your prayers and love and support and encouragement, me and my family and also my co-pastors, we are all together doing good ministry. The couple of months we had a wonderful baptisms and gospel prayer meetings, and we all together reaching the unreached people with love of Christ. So in India, very bad conditions is going on. Some places persecutions is going on, and corona is going on, whatever it may be. Our team pastors, me and my team pastors, we all together are reaching the people and places. We all also reaching through Bible distributions. We done through Friends Baptist Church family. So for your prayers and encouragement and love and sacrifice, because of your love only, I am here standing and doing ministry. And also, we are supporting whatever you are giving. We are sharing that gift to our team pastors. So please pray for us. Thank you for your love and encouragement and sacrifice. Thank you all. Praise the Lord.
Okay, there we go. He sure can sing, can't he? I really worked hard to get him there, but and I'm glad to know that since we've been apart over the last 4 or 5 years, you continue to improve. And son, I appreciate all your hard work in my absence, and you're doing a good job. Again, thank you for the music tonight, and the ladies that sang the song along with the choir. Boy, it was good too. And I thought they probably had their own bus there for a second, but we're glad to be. Is this online tonight? Can I ask that? Okay, all right. I got to be careful. I ask that question because there's some things I like to tell you, but I can't tell you everything if it's online, because there's some people that we work with that are in some pretty dangerous parts of the world, and literally their life is at stake because they preach the gospel. We had the privilege one time to drive back deep into a country that where Christians are still heavily persecuted, and we were there. They had suffered the loss of a number of different things because of flooding up in the mountains in this particular country, and so we sent some money over. God has provided R1 Ministries just in really kind of an amazing way. When we started off, this is just a little side note on our financial part of it. I asked the Lord, how in the world are we going to do this? And he gave me the verse from Psalm 37. I've been young and now I'm old. And that is getting truer and truer with each passing day. And yet I've never seen the righteous forsaken or a seed begging for bread. And just really believe that what God wanted us to do was to go. And as people asked, how do you finance it? We'll tell them and let God provide the money along the way. I'll give you one example of that. We were in Norway last February for almost the whole month. We got home right before from the pandemic hit, and they shut down all the travel. My son actually had a group in Romania. They flew back on the Saturday of the first travel ban, got back without a whole lot of problem, a little bit extra time through customs. But we got back from the Dominican in January, and when I got home, see, the day we got home or the day after, I got a letter in the mail, and it was from a gentleman that I think I may have met once or twice. He follows us on Facebook, and I'd played golf with him, and he was playing a golf match against a friend of mine, and my friend asked, hey, would you just play along with us? I'd be more than happy to. So out we played, and to be honest, I don't remember much about the day, and he said, I want you, my wife and I just recently relocated. We're in between churches. I see what you're doing, believe in your mission work, and we just wanted to send you a little check. Now, I've heard about things like this, but I never got one of these before. And it was a check for $10,000. And I opened the letter, and I went, oh. And Joy said, I wish I could have opened that letter. But God just provides along the way. And so I thank the Lord for that. He's been very good to us in that capacity on any number of levels. But one of the places that we're going, and I was talking to you about, we sent some money there to buy rice because they needed food because they had lost a lot of their crops and that sort of thing. So we went to this village where the local authorities kind of keep an eye on things. All of the church is out and open. It's got a cross on the outside of it. And when we got there, I wanted to go take pictures of the front of the building, and they would not let me. They said, no, you stay there. Give me your phone. We'll go take the pictures. And so they did that. And I've got a few of those pictures. And then I talked for about an hour, and these men were there, and they would have preferred that I taught all day long. They're just that hungry for the truth. And most of them, I think, had Bibles, but to get training as a pastor, they just don't have much opportunity for that. Well, when it was over with, they brought three of the pastors up front for prayer. One of them, because he'd become a believer and much of his family, they had basically been excommunicated from their village, which meant the kids could not go to school, very meek type of education, but they could not go to school. They lost out on all the benefits as well as some other persecutions along the way. I recently heard of some families in the same type of situation. They became believers. They began to worship the Lord, and their houses were burned down, and they were kicked out of their village altogether. And that's happened within the last few months. So there was one of those men we had prayer for. There was another man who a pressure release bomb had been placed under one of his meager pieces of farming equipment that he used to not only feed his family but make what little money he could. And when whatever it was moved, the bomb detonated. Fortunately, it did not completely detonate, but he lost that piece of equipment. And his family suffered greatly. The other one was a younger man whom apparently, and I don't understand how they do this, but apparently when the authority came, he had been selected by the leadership that if someone was going to go to prison, it was going to be him. And the reason why, he was younger, and they felt like physically he would have a much better opportunity of withstanding what he was going to face. And what he faced over a 7-month period of time was electrical shock treatment in order to try to get him to deny his faith. He did not do so. He was eventually released. And you certainly could tell the physical effects upon his body
from that sort of a thing. And yet, in spite of all of that, these men were hungry to receive God's word, and they are still remaining faithful to the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I tell you that not for you to feel sorry for them. They wouldn't want you to feel sorry for them. I think they would be like Paul of old. They would rejoice that they are suffering for the cause of Christ. I tell you that to just let you know that the gospel that we've been entrusted with is worth taking care of. It is worth taking care of. Tonight, I want to spend some time with you in 2 Corinthians chapter number 4. And in order to kind of set the tone for what's being said, let me just kind of give you a real brief summary of chapter 3. I really don't think that there's any part of the Bible, unless maybe it's the Psalms, but even the Psalms often are far better understood with a broader context of understanding. Like Psalm 23, when you read that understanding that David was a shepherd and some of the things that David faced as a shepherd, it gives a whole lot greater meaning to that psalm. But especially the New Testament letters, the books of the Bible that are written either in some sort of sequential order, like many of the Old Testament books, or the New Testament books in which Paul, in particular the letters to the churches, Paul is writing a letter to a church. It really is important that you understand kind of the sequence of what's going on through the course of the letter. And that's very important when you get to chapter 4 of 2 Corinthians, because in verse 1 it says, "Therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we receive mercy, we faint not." Now, I think probably you've heard, if you've been in church at any point in time, you've heard a pastor say to you, anytime you see the word therefore or wherefore, you should always look back and see what it is there for. In other words, you need to look back at the context. And as you study the Bible and as you study passages of Scripture, all Scripture really should be read in the context. You've got the context maybe of the particular chapter, the context of a section of a book, the context of the book itself, the context of the part of the Bible, and also the context of the whole Bible. So if you're really going to grasp all that's in the seven verses that I want to look at tonight, you really have to understand what Paul has been saying up to this point in time. That would be true whether he said therefore or not. But because he did say that, what he is getting ready to do, he's getting ready to tell the church at Corinth something else. He's taking what he's just got through saying, and he's building on that somewhat as a foundation to really drive home a point about something they ought to be doing. And in this case, what he's driving home is the idea that we've given a ministry that enables us to be faithful in carrying out the gospel to the world. Now, what he says in chapter 3 is he talks about not only his own life, but in particular their life, the believers' lives, as being living epistles. You can go back and read that later on. Some of you might glance at it right now, but the reality is he says we are living epistles. The word epistle simply means message. In other words, every believer is a living message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Our life, and by the way, you cannot take the gospel into the whole world without speaking the gospel. I'm not advocating here that the way to do evangelism is lifestyle, but I am telling you that your lifestyle ought to match the message. And your lifestyle is a tremendous opportunity at times to reveal the message of God's love as people see the transformation that took place in your life. That was as true with Paul as it was anyone. There's no question about that. But as he explains that, he goes even a little bit deeper when it comes to that, when he talks about the fact that, verse number 5, we're not sufficient of ourselves. This is chapter 3. Our sufficiency is of God. We're made ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And then he goes into an explanation that you really kind of have to make sure you kind of carefully read through it and understand what he's saying. Because he makes a comparison between the Old Testament law that was given to Moses and the New Testament truth that came through Jesus Christ. And he uses a word that we're going to see in chapter 4 that we use this morning, the word glory or the word glorious. And he talks about the Old Testament, the old letter that was given really was glorious. And he illustrates that because when Moses came down off the mountain, he had been in the presence of the Lord, and that message and that time with the Lord had so affected Moses' life that he had to veil his face. The glory of God that was reflecting off of Moses' face had to be veiled. And what he does after that is he begins to talk about how much better what Christ has done really is. And the glory of the New Testament, the glory of the message of the gospel, if I can just cut right to the chase, is far more glorious than the old, because the new message, what Christ did in fulfilling the law, put away the condemnation of the law. By the way, the law still has purpose in our life. It's not that the New Old Testament has no purpose, but we have now been delivered from the condemnation of the law. We've been delivered from all the ceremonies of the law, and we are now free in Jesus Christ. As he also talks about that, he talks about the fact that we have the opportunity now. Moses had to have his face veiled, but not us. And the veil's been torn, and we can actually behold the greatness of the glory of God. And he talks about that in verse number 18 of chapter 3 when he says, "We with an open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord." Now, I really believe what he's talking about there is this, that when you got saved, and I mentioned that this morning, the Bible says in Romans that we are adopted as children. And that is a wonderful, wonderful truth. And what that means is, and I've talked about this truth here before, but it fits the context tonight. I'm taken out of the family of the devil, and I'm placed into the family of God. But if that's all you know about adoption, you don't know enough. Because that's not all the Bible talks about when it comes to adoption. Matter of fact, the Bible talks in great detail about the fact that before the foundation of the world, God predetermined that all those in Christ would be adopted as his children. And that truth allows us to understand that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose, Romans 8:28. Why? Because those whom he did foreknow, he did also predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son. Here's what that means. In predetermining that every man who by faith would trust Jesus Christ would then be placed into Christ, would be adopted as a child, God also predetermined that every child he adopted, he would also make sure that that person would be just like Jesus. That's the great transformation of the glory of the gospel that every born-again person has. And Paul is referring to that reality here in chapter number 3. As he puts it all together, he says, "Therefore, seeing we have this ministry," what ministry? The ministry of being living epistles that have the opportunity to not only know the glory of God, but then to reveal the glory of God to those who don't know it. You have a calling upon your life. I have a calling upon my life. The calling that I'm talking about was not the calling to be a youth pastor. It's not the calling to preach the gospel in the position that I hold. It's not a calling to have been a pastor for 17 plus years. It's not even the calling that I have now to serve the servants of God globally. I have a calling on my life the moment that I got saved to be a living epistle, to make known the glory of salvation to anybody and everybody I come into contact with. I have that calling as an adopted child of God, and so do you. Now that sounds somewhat overwhelming. Let's just be honest, right? I mean, the reality is when we talk about taking the gospel into the whole world, did you see the stats tonight? I mean, there's, what, almost 30% of the world that don't even know the name of Jesus. There are several hundreds, a couple of thousand languages that don't even have a Bible. I'm not sure what the stat is now, but it's up there. I mean, we're talking trillions and billions of dollars. You ain't got that kind of money here, do you? So those are big stats, and the purpose of showing those stats is not to overwhelm us, but to just show us we need to do our part. But when we think about the grand picture of it all, we go, whoa, what are we going to do? It can be a little bit overwhelming. When you break it down just to the reality of taking the gospel to the person you work with, it can be a little bit intimidating, right? I'll say it is. I mean, right now in the workplace, can you even tell people about Jesus? I mean, we're living in a day and time, you got to be careful. You got to be careful about anything you say. Some of the old things, I was in Texas the other day, that's where my son lives, and I think I was ordering some food at a restaurant, and they asked for a name, and I told them my last name was Crockett. And, you know, in Texas, that used to be a really good thing, you know. And I got a brother named David and everything, and a nephew named David. I'm related. Ain't no question about that. And I kind of jokingly asked, and later on I thought, I'm not even sure I should have even asked that jokingly. Thankfully, I asked it to the right person. I said, is it still okay to be a Crockett in Texas? He said, it is so far. Well, I got news for me. It doesn't make a difference if it's okay to be a Christian. That doesn't change it. I still need to proclaim the gospel, right? I have a calling. But with that calling, Paul begins to talk about there are some definite challenges. That's why he says in verse number 1, we receive this mercy, we faint not. Well, why does he bring that up? The idea of fainting not is the idea of quitting. So he's motivated. The reality is, I'm motivated by the glory of the gospel. And because the ministry is so important, because it is so incredible, I'm motivated to stay with it. But when he says we faint not, that means Paul recognized that there are some challenges to the calling. And then he goes on to talk about them. Verse number 2. But have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. I would say the first challenge that Paul talks about really is the challenge of self, or the challenge of the flesh. That's why Paul says, listen, what we've done is we understand that if we're going to maintain and be faithful in the calling, there's some things that we've got to make sure that we get out of our life. There's some things that we've got to make sure that we do not do. Not only are we going to renounce anything that might be dishonest, that might be crafty, and some of this he's talking about even how he does ministry itself. Probably all of this kind of applies to that. We don't want to handle the word of God deceitfully. We're not going to sugarcoat it. We're not going to be ugly with it. By the way, God never intended for you to beat people up with the gospel. Amen. We were out one time. I was a youth pastor in Macon, or was it Atlanta? It was Macon, Georgia. So we're out knocking on doors. Back when that was a little more receptive. And I'm not saying you can't do it now, but it doesn't seem to be always most effective. So this teenage girl, she was knocking on doors, and a man came to the door. And by the way, this girl now is a doctor of education. She's a pretty smart girl. But back then, she was just a little bit extra bold. And I'm not recommending that you do this. Sometimes you learn from other people's mistakes. So the guy came to the door, and he basically just blew her off, rejected her. And she basically looked at him and said, okay, you reject the gospel, that's fine. Go to hell if you want to. That's basically, in so many words, what she told him. She came back and told us, I thought, oh my goodness, no. That's not what you do. We want to speak the truth in love, but we want to speak the truth. Now, if we were to go deeper into what Paul says even later on, you come down to verse number 8, Paul talks about all the persecution, all the suffering he goes through. We're troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in our body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. And I'll stop right there. Paul not only faced this idea of the flesh, but also the challenge itself came with suffering for Paul. Don't think for a minute that Paul enjoyed the pain that he endured because he's a preacher of the gospel. It never felt good physically. I mean, when he describes that, I think he does it later on here in this second letter to the church at Corinth in great detail. There's nothing good sounding about it. The young man that I told you about earlier, let me tell you something. He didn't look like he said, "Could I have another one of those electroshock treatments?" The families that have been ostracized because of that, the families that had their homes burned down. We met a lady one time in a village who now was out of this village. She was in another country. She had become a believer, and her husband had kicked her out of the village. She and her children were living in a little makeshift hut kind of outside the village, just doing anything she could to survive. One day she left the house, left the children in the house. Someone came to the house thinking that she and the children were gone and set the house on fire and burned her children alive in the house while she was gone. Don't tell me she was happy that had happened. But she hadn't lost her faith. There are challenges to the gospel. The reality for us, at least at this point in time, probably the challenge is not actual suffering. The challenge for us is probably more so the fear of suffering along the way. Your challenge to giving is the fear that if you give money to missions, you will miss out on something you want or something you need. You're more afraid of what you might not have rather than what you're going to give. You say, "How do you know that?" I've been there, done that. I still do it. I don't think we face much danger when we go into some of the places that we go. And although you should have seen the road we drove on, we go over these bridges that had 2x4 planks on them with holes in the bridges, and about 15 feet down was the river. My wife begged to get out of the van and walk over it while we drove the van over, and I wouldn't let her. So she made it. Praise God, we got back safe and sound. I can't tell you that I'm always excited, but I don't go with a little bit of, what's going to happen? Hope nothing does. Nothing, by the way, there's nothing wrong with having fear. There's nothing wrong with being afraid. Just don't let it stop you. There's challenges. There's another challenge. And that's in verse number 3. But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. There is the challenge of the enemy, right? The devil's real. Amen. He's alive and he's working. And he don't want you to be a good epistle. He doesn't want your message to be lived out. He wants you to fail. He wants to defeat you. And he's going at it the best that he can. And can I just tell you something? He's been doing it a long time. He's really good at it. He's taken down people that are far stronger than you think you are. You said, "Boy, you're really encouraging me now. I'm really going to sign up for this." Well, I'm not done yet, so just hang on. But let's face the reality. The God of this world has blinded the minds of them. We're living in a world that people just think if you preach the gospel, if you tell people a certain way of living is against the Bible and is wrong and is sinful, you are giving hate speech. There is some reality to that coming possibly very soon in this land. That if your pastor were to stand up and call certain things sin, that he could very well face some consequences because he does so. The enemy's at work. And he has blinded people's minds lest this glorious light that had to be veiled in essence on Moses' face, but we can behold, and now we have the opportunity to shine into all the world. It's what Jesus said when he talked about your little light, setting it up on a hill and not putting it under a bush. So there's a calling, and there is no question there are some great challenges to the calling, but there's an answer to the challenges. There is strength to be had. Matter of fact, there is strength that you already have. And the answer on that, what the strength is, it's simply Christ. I've got a calling, I've got challenges, but what I've got even better than the challenges, even stronger than the challenges, I have Jesus. I have Christ. That's what verse 5 through 7 says. For we preach not ourselves. It's not about your message. It's not about your life message. It is about your life reflecting the message of Jesus Christ. But we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord. And ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light and the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Let me just stop right there. He says that Christ is the light of the glorious gospel in verse number 4. He's the image, the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God. And we now preach that glorious gospel. We preach that glorious light. We don't do it based on who we are. We do it based on who he is. The light that God has commanded to shine out of darkness, it is the same light that has shined in our hearts and has given us the light to know that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. So we have that light that has been shined into our face, and we know how it impacted us. And now we take that light and we shine it into the face of those who are in darkness. But we have this treasure. It doesn't stop verse 7. I love verse 7. But we have this treasure. What treasure? We have the treasure of the light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. We have the treasure of the light that God has commanded to shine out of darkness. We have the treasure of the light that has shined in our hearts and has given us the light of the knowledge of Jesus Christ. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. What is that? In your body. In the person of the Spirit of God who lives inside of you. So that the excellency of the power is not of me and it's not of you, but it is of God. The power to defeat the challenges, to fulfill the calling, comes in the person and the message of Christ. Simply put, it's in the gospel. Let me just kind of illustrate it with a true life story. It's a lady in this same part of the world. She's a leper. She was kicked out of her village, not because she was a believer, but because her disease could have literally wiped them out. There's a home there in this particular country where this couple had become known as a house of prayer. It's not a healing thing. It's not. How many of you saw Ernest Angley growing up, the guy that used the healing evangelist used to hit people in the head, that sort of thing? It's not like that. It's not that at all. The guy was telling me a story. I can't tell you exactly what he told me because there was some language in there that wasn't the most appropriate. But he took somebody to some healing crusade, and this person had what did he have? He had I think he had epilepsy or something like that. He was having seizures or something like that. So this guy wanted to take me to pray. I want to be delivered from this. So he goes to this healing crusade, and they go into the room or whatever ahead of time, and the guy said, hey, I think it was an uncle or a grandfather or somebody like that, a family member very near. They want to be prayed for their seizures, for their epilepsy or whatever it was. And the guy says, oh, brother, we're not praying over that tonight. He said, oh, brother, let me tell you something. Yes, you are. And apparently the guy that took him was a real big guy. And the guy said, oh, no. Well, finally the guy let him know in no uncertain terms. Let me tell you something. If you don't pray over him, I'm going to do something. And he told him what he was going to do in not-so-Christian terminology. I'm not talking about that kind of thing, okay? I'm talking about here's a lady comes, and she's a leper. She's in trouble. And here's what they do. They bring her into their home and they begin to love her. And three times a day, I understand what they did was they took her, they prayed with her, and they read the scripture. And they read the scripture and they prayed and they read the scripture and they prayed. And she became a believer through the reading of the scripture and through prayer. And you know what God did? You know what God did? Anybody won't get what God do? He healed her. He sure did. He took away her leprosy. I saw her. I saw the clean skin. But it wasn't so she could stand up and say, look, my leprosy's gone. Once she had rebuilt her strength, she moved back to her village. And in her village, in her house, the last I heard, there were eight families gathering in her house every week, worshiping and praising God because the gospel had transformed her life. That is the power of the gospel at work. And I'm telling you, folks, God has given you and he has given me everything that we need to enable us to faithfully care for the gospel that's been entrusted into our care. That's the message of 2 Corinthians 4. You've got what it takes. You got a calling, yes. There's no denying that. And there are some pretty strong challenges out there. There's no denying that. Yourself is a, you, self's a big part of the challenge. Satan is definitely a very difficult challenge. He is doing everything that he can to stop the light from shining in the darkness. But the message of Christ cannot be stopped. It is greater than you, and it is greater than the devil, and it can overcome any darkness that this world can produce. So know and understand, yes, you've been entrusted with the gospel, but God, with what he's entrusted you with, has also given you everything that you need to enable you to do exactly what it is that God's called you to do. When it comes to giving, God impresses on your heart a certain maybe percentage that you ought to give of your income, and you maybe you begin to sit down and you begin to try to figure out, I don't think I can do that. Let me tell you something. God will enable you to do it. I remember I was sitting down one time with a financial planner. He's looking at my finances. Weren't too exciting. But he looked at my giving. He said, you give too much. He literally told me, he said, you give too much. I said, thank you for your advice, but I'm not going to stop giving what God told me to give. Can I tell you something? I wasn't giving too much. It didn't make sense. But I had a whole lot more than I ever thought I'd have. Still do. Amen? God calls you to go, you can go. My wife would tell you, if you asked her, when God gave me peace about this ministry that we're in, she said, you know, I felt a little bit like, and she'll tell you like this. You ever watch the movie Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade? He gets right to the end of it, and he's getting ready to go, and he's getting ready to get the Holy Grail, and there's that big chasm, big dark hole. And his last clue, one of his last clues was take a step of faith. The old trusty whip couldn't get him across, and he's sitting there looking at it. His dad's dying, I think, in the movie, and he's got to get to that Holy Grail so his dad can take a drink out of the cup supposedly Jesus drank out of before he was in the Last Supper. And all he's got is a step of faith in this big old dark hole. And if you've seen the movie, you know what happens. If you haven't seen the movie, tough, I'm going to spoil it for you. He takes a step, and a walkway appears one step at a time. The whole thing didn't appear except one step at a time. He got across. She'll tell you, when my husband told me this is what we're getting ready to do, she said, I felt a whole lot like Indiana Jones. I think that's a pretty good description. But God has provided every step of the way. If God calls you specifically to go, you don't have to know how he's going to get you there. All you got to know, he's called you. And God will take care of the rest. Let's pray together. Father, thank you again for your word. And Lord, again, I pray you'd bless the word. Lord, I can't expect you to bless my words, but I can't expect you to bless your word. So Lord, tonight, help each one of us to grasp this truth, this reality. Yeah, we do have a calling to be living ministers, living messages of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, there are some great challenges in front of us. Lord, far more than maybe even what I've talked about here. But Lord, help us to never forget that in the person of Jesus Christ, we have all the strength that we will ever need to faithfully live out the calling. Father, really this week we're faced with a couple of things. We're faced as a church with what are we going to do about the responsibility that the church has to take the gospel in all the world. And Lord, there are two specific things that we know are a part of that. One is financial, and the other is just giving of ourselves to go right here at home and all across the globe. Lord, I pray that every person in this room, every person in this church would get a hold of the fact that you want to use them in the mission of taking the gospel to all the world. Lord, grow the giving capacity of this church. Grow the heart for giving of this church during this time. And help people to just simply seek your will and do what it is that you call them to do. And Father, my prayer is that we would all be faithful witnesses of the gospel. But Lord, even more specifically, would you reach out and would you touch someone or maybe several someones and call them out into the gospel ministry, the mission ministry. Lord, help all of us to be willing to do that. Lord, I pray that you'd bless and you'd work. Bless as we come to the close of this service and bless each one of the next services on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday as well. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Pastor?
Amen. Let's stand to our feet. Let's stand to our feet. We're going to sing a verse of invitation with the Lord speaking to you. Would you slip out and come to an altar?
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching, watching for you. For me, come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling all sinner, come home. Why should we tarry when Jesus is pleading, pleading for you and for me? Why should we linger and heed not his mercies? Mercies for you and for me. Come home.
Father, we thank you for the wonderful evening that we've had together. We thank you for the great day that it's been as we focused on the call to missions, the call to reach the world, the call to share the gospel. Lord, that you've given this light in earthen vessels. And Lord, I'm just so thankful for that. I pray tonight that you use us mightily to impact our world around us and use us mightily to help get the gospel to the uttermost part of the earth. And we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, don't forget tomorrow night at 6:30 that you need to be here. We're going to have another great time together in the Lord. And looking forward to seeing you. God bless you. You are dismissed. Amen.